We bring to you the inspired word of God as you listen to the teachings and preachings of the servant of God, Hosanna David, preaching the end time gospel.
We are here on a journey to a home. There is a battle to be won. There is a crown that is set ahead of us. The Savior is waiting already. He is prompting us, daughter, run. Son, pick up your load and run. Forget about weakness. My grace is sufficient for you. The devil, the killer, the destroyer, the thief is here on earth with you, seeking for somebody to devour. He is filled with great wrath because he knows that his time is short. He has lost everything, but he has not given up. Do you know you are here for a purpose? Is life about growing up, going to school, get good degrees, get a good job, have a good family, and then build houses and make money, make a name? It is more than that. Father, we invite your spirit to come and speak to us today. May your spirit release your light. A Hebrew writer says, "Thou who's a mighty one, chaos and darkness heard and took their flight. Where the gospel way, where the gospel light, share not his glorious way, let there be light." The same words of this hymn we proclaim today, that in any heart, any life, there is darkness in this heart. In every family, there is darkness. Let that same word that was spoken in Genesis chapter 1 verse 3, that let there be light. Let that same word be released into our lives in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. May your light shine upon our hearts. Amen. Lord, if we come here weak, we don't want to live here weak. We want to live here strong. We want to live here glowing. We want to live here stretching. We want to live here changed and transformed. Jesus Christ. We cover the whole atmosphere and the whole of this environment with the fire of the Holy Ghost. We stop the gates of hell. For it is written, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Take all the glory, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Give a clap of it to Jesus. The topic is challenges of useful loss. Overcoming the challenges of loss. With what? With the grace of the marvelous God. Quickly, let's turn the Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. Following. 2 Timothy 2, 22. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Praise the Lord. This is a very crucial topic. It is so wide, but we will just do our best by the grace of God to narrow it down so that we can live here with something useful. Lust. Lust is not something that is strange. Lust is a strong, sinful desire. It's a strong longing that somebody has in order to achieve something. It is a psychological emotion. Lust is a strong desire to have sex with someone that you are not married to, and oftentimes without the usual feeling of love. So, lust is almost the opposite of love. Because the Bible says that God so loved the world that, you know what? He gave his only begotten son. So, if somebody loves, the person tends to give out. But when somebody is lusting, the person becomes selfish and wants to satisfy personal desire. So when we talk about lust, lust is lifting one's own desire in life beyond the normal. Desire is not something that is bad. Normal range of desire is something that everybody has. Maybe you must have had the feeling of, okay, when I grow up, I will buy a limousine. Praise the Lord. When I grow up, this is the kind of house I'm going to be. That is a desire. It's just a wish. But when it graduates from that level to the level of a 15-year-old boy trying to drive the best car in town, then something is wrong. As a matter of fact, what that child should desire at that level is to get the best degree in school, to be among the best in the class. Lust has a very devastating effect. If you look at the society today, we see one type of lust or the other. You see people have become so selfish that a girl can just get dressed on the street from the house, moving along the street, and people will be calling on her. Why? How can I help you? He said, yes, I want to take you out. For what? I just want to spend some time with you. And then what will happen? Yes, when I take you out, I will buy some food for you. Then after that, what happens? Yes, you know, we just need to spend some time together and know each other better. What is talking now? What is talking? That is a voice of lust. And if that girl is not careful enough, that girl will wake up on someone's strange bed. We have a very typical example that we will consider today in Genesis chapter 3, because that is where the whole problem of man started from. There is no challenge on earth we face that cannot be traced to this Genesis chapter 3. Every challenge we have, even the challenge in our head, the challenge we have in our longings, in our desires, even the challenge of lust can be traced to this place fully. Now look at the discussion with the discussion between the woman and the serpent. The serpent said, okay, let me take it from verse 1. Genesis 3, 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, they shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye do what? Lest ye do what? And that is the implication. So if you look at the whole implication of lust, it leads to the three different types of death. Number one, death, which is a physical death. Lust can lead to physical death. If a son or a daughter is not satisfied with her level of living and decided to go for armed robbery, decided to go for prostitution, that person can meet with death. And then also, another type of death, which is spiritual death, separation from God, separation from the spirit and from the things of God, and being alive in the things of the flesh. The second death, the Bible says that he that lives for pleasure, that person is already dead. So somebody can focus the whole of the mind on living for pleasure, lusting after things, lusting after money, lusting after women, lusting after men, lusting after the beautiful things in the world. And the person takes that as the major concern of life. And all the person thinks about is how to satisfy that lust. That person, the Bible says, is already dead. That person is dead. Then another death, which is the most dangerous of all, that I do not pray for even my worst enemy, is the death of death. Praise the Lord. And that is everlasting death, hellfire. So this loss can lead to these three deaths we just mentioned now. God said, the day you eat of this fruit, you shall surely do what? Die. And the serpent said, you shall not surely die. It is a lie. Children of God, we are living in a generation where the scriptures are fulfilling so fast. The Bible says that if the foundations are being destroyed, what shall the righteous do? Today, the whole foundation of goodness, the foundation of virtue, the foundation of morality is being destroyed. Especially now that we have men who have not God in their hearts, but we push them into power, and those who refuse to push decided to push themselves into power by all means. And when they get there, they break the foundations, they destroy the foundation of goodness. The serpent said, you shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Now the devil is introducing something that is called pride, which is a type of lust. He's introducing pride. We are going to go there. Look at verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Verse 7, and the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. This is the beginning of the history of lust. We'll come back to that passage. What is youthful lust? Who is even a youth? A youth is a young adult that is growing into full maturity. That is a youth. And youth is always differentiated by age. After puberty, you come to adolescence. Adolescence is a period that you are being translated into adulthood. And it's a very dangerous moment in the life of everybody that has appeared on this earth. It is the most dangerous after the age of infancy. The next dangerous moment in life is the moment of youthful age. Youthful lust is a strong sinful desire that is associated with youth. Let's look at our Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 11 verse 9. Now look at what the preacher was telling the youth. He said, rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart shed thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thy heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou, better know this, for all these things God will bring. God will bring thee into judgment. He said, this time is a time, this period is a time that you feel so much pleasure. You get so along with the things of this world. You feel so okay. You are lively. You are so active in life. And because you have no restriction, maybe in your head, you are agile, your mind is so inquisitive, you want to do this, do that, do this. And in course of doing that, the tendency of offending God, of living without God, is always unavoidable. Except in rare cases. And he said, remember that now that you are jumping up and down, God is going to bring these things into judgment. Now look at verse 10. Therefore, remove sorrow from thy heart, and put away evil from thy flesh. For childhood and youth are vanity. Verse 12, chapter 12, verse 1. Remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth, when the evil days come not, nor the years drawn out, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Praise the Lord. In this our environment, how many of us have seen a man that is 60 years old, yet he's putting on earring? Have you seen any man like that? 60, in this our environment in Nigeria here. Have you seen any man? 60. What about youth? Have you seen people between the ages of maybe 18, 25, 30? Putting on earring. And when you look at the ears of some matured men whose brain have realized all their mistakes in life, the hope will still be there, but they will say, this earring wasted my time. There is no need to wear it again. And the preacher here, the preacher of Ecclesiastes says, for childhood and youth are vanity. He said the stage of youth is in vain. Why is it in vain? Because many youth don't devote their time to building their foundation for tomorrow. And all they do is jump up and down. Why is it that youth have more challenges if you are 13 to between 11 to 18, 19, 20, you will know that some changes have taken place in your life, in your body physically. Is that true? At the stage of youth, this is the youthful stage, is the stage that you grow into maturity. And there are lots of chemical processes that go on in your body. Like this, someday you may just wake up and discover that you are.
Junior, hey my baby, that junior, the mind of that junior
charge it, buy a new phone and give it to your 3-year-old daughter or 3-year-old boy. They will business it for you. Even the one that cannot talk very well, the first thing they do was to give their phone. That he opened it for me. They will locate the game and start playing. Parents shouldn't deceive themselves. Times have changed. The tide that we are moving against is running so fast that we need extra time. We need extra grace to enable us to overcome the wiles of the devil this time around. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We have three types of lust. Three types of lust. And we'll just look at them. 1 John 2:15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Three types of lust that are mentioned here. And this lust will take us back to Genesis. Genesis chapter 3. We have the lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh. Listen, man, let me tell you, woman. The way you were created in the Garden of Eden, that is not what you are now. Some things have gone wrong with you. The Adam God created, before the corruption, before the fall, that Adam was looking at a naked woman and there was no negative reaction. That woman was looking at a naked adult and there was no negative reaction. But the moment they ate that fruit, things changed. And they realized that they were what? They were naked. They discovered, they knew that they were naked. But their eyes had been open ever since, physically and spiritually. They never saw that nakedness because the glory of God was covering them. Now let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. We have two nations in this world. Only two nations. Look at verse 5. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and
evil.
Let me ask a very simple question. Girl, why don't know boy? Man, why don't know girl? The behavior will be the same. Does it remain the same? If you are a parent and you know that your child can just get naked from the bedroom and get dressed, undressed themselves in your presence, once something has happened to them in the secret, they will start displaying it in the public. Let me tell you something. Sex can change your brain. I have been doing research for how many months now on your brain on lust. Your brain. How does lust affect your brain? Because it's a brain thing. When you have problem with lust, it is your brain that is getting lost. It is your brain working with your mind that makes you to get lost. May God help us.
Amen.
I said, may God help us.
Amen.
Now, the devil said, if you eat this fruit, you shall be as gods. Do you have King James? King James Version. What do you see there? And the word in the Hebrew is Elohim. Ye shall be is in the plural form. Ye shall be as gods. Who is gods? Who? When you say gods, small letter G-O-D-S, what does it mean? So remember, these people have been created in the image of God himself. And the devil is making another mention that this time around is not like God, your father. You will be like me, gods. That is its nature. So the nature that man fell into was the nature of the devil. And that is the major reason Jesus had to come and give birth to us again so that we can behave like our father as it were in the Garden of Eden. The lust of the flesh. Now, look at the three types of lust. We talk about, we just read in 1 John 2:15-16. The first thing the woman did, the woman saw was good for food to feed her flesh. What might you eat food? Is it not to feed your body? To feed your flesh, is that not so? That is a loss of the flesh. The woman saw it and said, this one is good for my flesh. It was good to her that it was good for food. And then, the loss of the eyes. Verse 3, chapter 3, verse 6b says, it was pleasant to the eyes. The woman saw that the tree, the fruit, was pleasant to the eyes. That is the loss of what? The loss of the eyes. And then the pride of life. The pride is the excess desire to reach oneself beyond what one really is. When you are living in first me and first you are living a life that a shed of a governor is supposed to live. What is that called? It's pride. It's pride. The Bible says no man should think of themselves more than what they are. So, these three things, it was lust that made the woman to eat that food. She lost them after the food to feed her flesh. And the thing was so desirable to her sight. And not just that too, the serpent told the woman that you shall be wiser, you shall be wiser, you shall be wiser. Lust is wrong. Let's quickly look at the major categories of youthful lust. The first one that is so disturbing in this of our generation is the issue of the pursuit of pleasure. The pursuit of pleasure. Please look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. What are you living for? For your destiny? Or for pleasure? What is the reply? Times have changed. If we decide to line people up now and use a spiritual scanning machine to scan people, you will be surprised that some people you see so innocent here are no longer virgins. And we have some Maradonas who are boys in church. They are very good Christian brothers. Hey, hello sister, hello sister. They know how to penetrate their way through. But there is only one thing they are looking for. The way people are pursuing pleasure today, in Nigeria, today, the issue of gay marriage is taking all over the place. There was a girl that came to me one day for counseling. She said that they said I would die. They said I would die. Let me stop right there. Let me just stop there. And as in course of praying with her, the Lord opened my eyes and I saw where her problem came from. And I told her, God said, you had an illicit sexual relationship. That is what landed you in the wilderness. Because your life now is being lived in the wilderness. And she said, yes. The church has become too quiet on this issue. The Bible says, can a man put fire into his bosom and not be burnt? Is it possible? I tell you today, sex is fire. And the Songs of Solomon says, do not awaken love until it so pleases. That means until you are matured to have sex, until you are matured to enter a loving relationship with your husband or your wife, do not even wake it up. Because some people, because of everybody is doing it, let me do it too. Everybody is doing it. They went and tried it. And from the day they tried it, it became a problem. Have you seen anybody that likes alcohol? Yet the person is not a perpetual drunk. Eh? Have you seen anybody that plays with cigarettes and the person is never addicted to smoking? Is it possible? I told a lady one time, I said, why don't you just give God some time in your life and stop moving up Bible. Somebody is not yet married and she is living for pleasure already. I have heard youth confessing to me, I have problem with sleeping alone in the night. There are some of you here, somebody has already collected your number. The thing has not happened, but it's about happening. If you do not retrace your step, trouble is ahead. There was a 15-year-old girl who was so proud, and she was saying it was over the net. She said, I have slept with 300 men at 15 years old. And the mother was so shocked in the school, anywhere. And the generation we are living in is has a very bad culture. That is a sexual culture. When you go to Facebook, what do you see, guys? When they snap, I don't know where they bring that posting from. They will post somehow, squeeze their mouth, open their breast, and they will say, shake out this sexy baby. All you do on Facebook is snap yourself, that you don't read anything meaningful. Snap yourself and put it there. If they look at the phones of many people, there's something that is running now called sexting. A young man came to my house when I was calling. All the rubbish his girlfriend was doing were in his phone. He was moving with the phone like that and carrying the nude picture, the naked picture, and all the rubbish he got in the phone. And somebody can just get it. The next thing you see, you are at the net. Many people have committed suicide. How can this happen to me? This boy has betrayed me. I can't stand this shame. The next thing, they go and hang themselves and go to hell. There was a church. Children were gathering themselves. They were laughing and were just so amused with themselves. And then a priest just said, let me go and look at what they are doing. The priest got there. They were watching the blue film and their phone. For your information, there is a level and amount of pleasure that your brain can handle. When you take some drugs sometimes in the hospital, you will feel dizzy. Is that not so? You feel dizzy. There are some you take, the doctor will say, please, sleep, don't move. And when somebody takes hard drugs like cocaine, the brain will become, will be malfunctioning. This is something that starts very small, but it ends in a very big way. The quest for pleasure. One day, David was on top of his roof, the roof of his house, and as he was there, he saw a woman, the wife of Uriah, taking her bath. And then David was looking, and the Bible says the woman was so beautiful to look upon. And as David was looking and looking, his body started catching fire. And he said, somebody, do you know that simple thing, that simple looking, led David to the scene of adultery. He murdered somebody, a faithful servant, and David lost four of his children because he said, this man shall pay for it four times. And he paid four times. I don't deceive myself. I will never deceive. If you are coming for counseling, don't open your breast and come and meet me. You have to cover it first before you come. Because lust is in your brain. It is right here in the brain. Can you look at an old woman that is 80 years old, a widow, weeping because of the only child, and you will not cry? Is it possible? Can you control yourself from crying? Some of us spend our time watching Nollywood. Nollywood, is there anything good about Nollywood?
No.
Is there anything?
No.
It's about boyfriend, juju, herbalist, pastor, and that is all. And when you put all those rubbish into your brain, somebody will come and make love to you in the dream. And you run to the church. And some of you don't even go to the church, you enjoy it. Praise the Lord. Then also, God deliver us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Then money. How many of us know that Islamic banking has come to Nigeria? Do we know that?
Yes, sir.
Where you will get money, huge amount of money to do your business. And people are leaving Christianity today because they said the church is not helping us. The church doesn't give us money. They asked, they said, oh yeah, that's God, another offering. And you go to another place where they say, take. And you say, now this God who pass, not be Jesus, now Muhammad. These people are taking over everywhere. And some you say, I can't do without a boy. Even though he's a Muslim, God will change him. Who told you? God will change them. Yes, we know. But the Bible says, let him that thinketh his thoughts take heed lest he fall. What do we need to do in a time like this? Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation and appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. How many of us have a secure tomorrow? There is a word out of experience I use all the time. If you are a young person, you have God, you are a believer, and you have not entered into this sexual world, you are still keeping yourself. 50% in life, you are successful. 50% in life, you are a successful girl, you are a successful man. If you can keep only that law first, only that one first, because if you then go to school and boy don't enter the head, girl don't enter the head, it could sit down for your brain. When you debate, you're not going to enter again. It is the beginning of failure. And we have many people today who cannot marry again. We have boys, they can't get married again. If you give them work, they can't work again. Because all they do is drink, live useless life. We have girls who cannot stay. A brother was telling me last year, he said the wife he married in the night took phone and called a boyfriend in his presence. He said, since you cannot satisfy me on this bed, I'm calling somebody that will satisfy me. She started it one day and it became an addiction. How are you living your life in this house? Are you lusting after the things of this world? Are you leaving your foundation? Are you having a mother who is looking for 40,000 naira to start up a business? And you are wearing the Brazilian hair costing you 180,000 naira, 300,000 naira. Bad on your head.
Error.
Bad on your head. I want to talk to your father this moment. This is a generation that is destroying the foundation so fast. Every sector of the society is corrupt. People now look better to themselves when they dress as prostitutes and hooligans than looking like gentlemen and gentle ladies. Talk to your God. How are you living your life? Is your phone having pornographic picture or pornographic film now? And you take the phone to the church, you take it everywhere, your laptop is having this somewhere. You are destroying your life. You think you are enjoying, you are lusting after this thing. One day, you will get lost if you don't change. Round up your prayer. Father, we give you worship for everything you have done for us. Lord, we have been born into a culture that has no regard for the truth. We all here, we are products of our culture and tradition. But today we have resolved to live above our culture. Any boy, any man, any woman, any girl in this house, if your destiny is threatened already, may the Lord God Almighty come and recreate you again. Holy Spirit, build on this word in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray.
We hope you were blessed by this message. For more information, visit our website www.eagleeyeopener.com. Email us at hosannadavid@ymail.com or info@eagleeyeopener.com. God bless you.